time for the 49ers Rush Podcast.
Number 43 on the 49ers roster countdown, we're just over halfway, linebacker Demetrius Flannigan-Fowles. But we call him DFF, or at least I do. I couldn't even put his full name in the little prompt there. It didn't fit, so I apologize to the family. But DFF hopefully will suffice. No, not trying to upset anybody. He's earned everything. I just couldn't make it fit. I apologize about that. It's a longer name. But he is, man, he's fun. He's number 43 on our list, but he wears number 45. 6'2", 225, 25 years old, entering... This is a little confusing. He's actually entering in his fourth season, but his quote-unquote rookie year was not accrued. He was cut from the practice squad, brought back to the practice squad, not activated enough games. So even though he's been in the NFL for 4 years, this technically is his third year, which we'll get into a little bit more of the contractual obligations because of that. What it basically means is he's going to be around at least one more year after this on a super cheap deal because he's still a restricted free agent. If he had, if that first year he was active in a certain number of games, 3 or 4, he would have been a free agent, a true free agent next year, but he's not going to be. So this kid's interesting. Converted from safety. 49ers love those types of players. Safeties turn to linebackers because they like that speed, the sideline to sideline. Grew up in Arizona, played for two different high schools, Tucson, Arizona, then Mountain View High School his junior, senior year, both in Arizona. Chose to stay in Arizona. He went to Arizona University, the Wildcats, and was a general studies major. Now, couple interesting things about DFF. Grew up, this self-proclaimed, this is not our interpretation, as a quote-unquote mama's boy, where he would regularly have date nights with his mom growing up and began playing football at the age of 6. Had an uncle who signed him up, got him very, very active in that, and, you know, kind of played all over the place. He played safety, wide receiver as a sophomore in high school. Then as a junior, he was a defensive end and was first team all Arizona as a defensive end. Athleticism's always been off the charts. Then he goes to Arizona and starts as a safety. So, like, again, he's played defensive line, he's played wide receiver, he's played safety, he's played linebacker. He's kind of done it all. And this happens sometimes whenever you have these guys, you know, you look at his height, weight, you know, 6'2", 225. Do you balloon him up and make him bigger? Do you slim him down and make him quicker? What do you do with players like that? Well, he's bounced all over the place, and I think linebacker is where he's going to be for the rest of his career, especially with the trend of the way the position is evolving in the NFL, where you want these super fast linebackers that can fly back and forth. It's imperative. You got to have speed. Speed kills in today's NFL. You know, it's funny. You look at, like, John Lynch, right, who was a big safety even for back in his day. He might be, he's almost too big for a linebacker now. He might be a defensive end if he came out in the NFL today at his height, weight, and speed. But anyway, it just shows that it's different. So, you know, you look at kind of what he has done, very active in the community. DFF, very, very active in the community in Santa Clara and does a lot, which you got to love. Now, let's look at his athletic profile and kind of what this is. Didn't get a combine invite. This is an undrafted free agent. So draft profiles, draft write-ups, you know, combine measurements, those are a little fluky. It's a little bit different. Ran a 4.58. Pretty dang good in the 40-yard dash. So the speed, check. 3-cone, 7.25. Very, very bad. This is a big reason why he couldn't play safety and why he went undrafted and was a conversion, a development, a project player, but now it's starting to pan out because, again, the 49ers, one of the things they're better at than anything. You know, everybody wants to talk about Shanahan scheme and whatever else, and those things are huge, important, and we'll spend so many hours debating those things. But at the end of the day, it's Jimmy's and Joe's, not X's and O's, the old coaching axiom. You got to get the guys. Well, here we have, in Demetrius Flannigan-Fowles, we have a guy. He just had to be sculpted into the NFL. So it took a year, you know, basically redshirted his first year in the NFL, and then slowly was brought into play, and it's starting to pay dividends. Because, again, 7.25 3-cone, you're not playing safety in the NFL. You can't do that. That's Roy Williams back in the day for the Cowboys. That position has been phased out. It just doesn't work anymore. It's a passing league now, right? So he needed time to convert to the linebacker position. And it's worked out well. Has a 34 and a half inch vertical. That's all right. Not great. Was drafted, or, you know, went undrafted, sorry. His quote-unquote rookie year was 2019, undrafted free agent with the 49ers. Bounced off and on the practice squad, never elevated, never active. And then in the year 2020, finally, with, you remember all those stupid injuries, finally got on the active roster. And so that was his true rookie year. So in 2020, he played in 11 games, one start, nine tackles, a lot of his special teams. And then last year, 2021, 17 games, two starts, 29 tackles. Got a lot more playing time whenever Fred Warner was out, Drake Greenlaw was out. Then when Warner came back, Aziz was out. He worked his way up into that linebacker four spot. But when somebody was out, he jumped to linebacker three and did pretty well. I'm going to be honest, like, not great. But when you're talking about a linebacker four getting spot work as a linebacker three, just understand, it just takes time. And missed tackles were a little bit of a concern. That's a little bit of an issue. We'll talk more about that in a second. But here's the most important part, okay, that you've got to understand with DFF. High upside, great speed, nice body, coverage upside, even though we haven't seen it too much, very limited snap count, and special teams. He's all over the place in special teams. And so in 2021, he had 545 snaps total. 166 of those were on defense. The rest were special teams. So you're talking about almost 400 snaps on special teams last year. Those are the things where linebackers, wide receivers, safeties excel at. If you can make yourself valuable there, it's very easy to latch onto a roster and stay active, because those special team things, especially this year with Snyder coming in as special needs coordinator, the new coordinator, there's a premium in money and draft picks and free agent on in roster spots on special teams, and DFF's going to help with that. Okay, that's huge. So again, just to kind of finalize the long term, this whole list is about most impactful for the 2022 season. That's why we have them at number 43. But long term, yeah, it's quite possible, because he's a restricted free agent next year, because, again, he didn't accrue a season his true rookie year. So this is third year. Next year will be his fourth. In actuality, his fifth, but contract-wise, fourth. So he's restricted next year. So he doesn't get to negotiate a new deal or whatever. The 49ers will tender him, probably with like a fourth-round pick, and that will, you know, equate out what his pay will be. He won't get a negotiate or anything like that. A team could come trade for him. Not going to happen. Almost never happens in today's NFL. So we're going to have him next year locked up, which means Aziz and Dre Greenlaw, they're contract years. So there's a strong possibility, looking long term, Fred Warner's locked up long term. You got DFF for at least one more cheap year, and Oren Burks. That could be your three starting linebackers next year. Now, it's not a bad thing. None of those guys are bad. None of them are Drake Greenlaw or Aziz. So this might be the last year of spoils. And if DFF can make a jump, it might make it pretty easy for the 49ers to say, you know what, guys? Go get paid Greenlaw. Go get paid Aziz. We'll just keep raking in all those compensation picks, because both those guys will get paid compensation pick type money. It does kind of stink that they're off-ball linebackers, because they're usually cheaper deals, but both those guys are going to be in kind of the $5 to $6 million range, maybe more. I'm talking low end. And if that's the case, you're talking six-round draft comp pick coming back, very similar to what happened with Arden Key, right? Anyway, back to DFF this year for 2022. He's got three starts. He's played in 28 games total, which is really good for an undrafted free agent. He's found his way and made himself valuable. He was held out of camp and OTAs just as precaution, had some lingering issues, nothing of significance there. Now, if you look at what he's been able to do in his 28 games, he's got 38 tackles. So most of those are on special teams. He shows up pretty good. We talked about his snap rate, which is good. 166 snaps on defense last year. Missed tackles are his issue. It's a small sample size, but he had four missed tackles last year and only 21 total tackles. That's a missed tackle rate of 16%. Small sample size, so you don't want to blow it too out of proportion. NFL linebackers don't have 16% missed tackle rates. Quan Alexander got pretty close to that a couple times. But again, he made up for it because he would force turnovers. That's who Quan was. Electrifying for both teams, right? So put this into perspective. Dre Greenlaw, one of the reasons why I love him so much, had 5 missed tackles the entire 2020 season. He had 86 total tackles. That was a 5.5% missed tackle rate. DFF last year, small sample size, 16% missed tackle rate. That's what he's got to improve. The 49ers love his speed. They love his attitude. They love his coverage upside. They love him in the community. He's a locker room guy, glue guy. A lot of fun. So what does 2022 look like for him? Going to be the 4 or 5 linebacker. And Aziz might not be ready week one. Might not be ready for the first kind of month of the season. I don't know. There's a lot. Not one, but 2 surgeries is rough. Gosh, I hope Aziz is back. We deserve the NFL. Just football fans in general need to see a healthy Fred Warner, a healthy Dre Greenlaw, and a healthy Aziz. That just, even if this is the last season it's going to happen. We deserve it. Everybody deserves it. That's what football is made for. You get to see those 3 guys running around on the field at the same time. It's almost unfair just how stacked that group is. But DFF might be starting week one as the same backer, that number 3. They only get about 20% of the snaps, but still, it's an impact play. He comes in against the run, helps out for sure, and he's good against the pass as a number 3 linebacker. He really, really is. But can he stay ahead of Oren Burks? They paid him pretty good money. So that's going to be, this is the type of competition that you have at that position. Oren Burks was a borderline starter for Green Bay. He comes here, he might be number 5. So we'll have to see what happens there. He's sticking around this year, next year, no doubt about it. He's going to make the roster, especially with Aziz somewhat in question. He's making the roster. You keep 5 linebackers because special teams is huge. Sometimes you keep 6 if there's 6 stud special teamers, but I think this year they'll only be keeping 5. And again, next year could be number 2. So that's DFF. A lot of fun. Self-proclaimed mama's boy, active in the community. Fun player. I mean, he flashes. Whenever you watch tape, you're like, ooh, like it jumps off. You see the speed, but it's such a limited sample size where he only gets a couple plays a game outside of special teams. So I'm excited for this guy. Man, it could be a week one starter. I hope Aziz is back, but 49ers are in good hands. The depth that they have built at this position, it's going to pay dividends. Really, really is. And if DFF surprises, could be a long-term starter next year, 2023. So I want to say thank you to Anthony and Josh, producers of this series. We're just going to keep counting them down.